Hi, hello, I am the Cyber Reef Guru. Thank you so much for watching. Today we are back in the garage to do a follow-up on this Bosch router table. So I posted a video a few years or so ago about me assembling it and starting to use it. I have a large number of cuts and trims and all sorts of things that I have done on this router table, and I kind of just want to talk about the pros and cons of this table, the things that I like and the things that I don't like. And so if you like this type of content, please consider subscribing, ringing that bell, very important these days. We do all sorts of woodworking videos here as well as CNC videos. So again, if you like that, please consider that subscription. That would really help the channel out a lot. All right, so let's go ahead and dig into this table and kind of talk about the features of the table, the things that that are nice and the things that are maybe not so nice. All right, so right off the bat, you have this aluminum / cast iron top. I say slash because I'm not entirely sure that it's cast iron. It kind of feels like it. But it's got this funny texture to it, so it's not smooth like the cast iron tabletop on the bandsaw or the table saw. So it has these two wings here that you can move in and out and adjust for the dust collection and for whatever material you're cutting. These are really nice, super helpful. I like them. It has this T-track system across the top where you can use a feather board like right here. I'll be honest, haven't really used it ever for anything. Occasionally, whenever I'm routing, I might push the feather board down, but the type of things that I'm routing most frequently are things like cutting boards and large edge profiles, where this feather board just doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. You do have the dust collection port here in the back, and this entire fence unit slides forwards and backwards. There are graduated lines here on the tabletop that show the distance that you are away from the center line of the bit, so that is super helpful when you want to do a specific depth of cut. Now, I will tell you that these lines are not terribly precise. They're pretty thick, so if you want to hit an inch on the mark, for example, you get a fair amount of play with this with the fence system, so you do have to do some measurements to make sure that you are spot on the money if you need something accurate. On the front here, we have the power switch. This is really useful. So the router actually plugs into a receptacle in the back here. There is a separate second receptacle here in the back, presumably for some sort of lighting or something like that, or maybe even for a dust collection system like a vacuum or something. I don't use the second plug. So it is open on the front here, so the router just sticks in the bottom. I did make a lovely little stand for this unit. It is on wheels, so I can cart it around in the garage. It works very well. I did end up putting two cinder blocks in the base of the unit because the wheels are kind of small. And what I found when I was routing, it actually was moving around a lot because there's just not a lot of weight to this unit. So putting those cinder blocks in there really give it some stability. When I lock the wheels into place, they're not moving and it doesn't slide like it was doing originally whenever I first installed this. All right, so I talked a little bit about the features of the unit itself. Let's talk about some more of the things that I like about it. So like I mentioned, the graduations on the top here are really, really nice. Having this power on the front, this is super convenient. I don't think I would ever trade this for anything else at all. Being able to adjust the fence back and forth and at various angles is very nice as well, and slide these open and closed. All right, so let's go ahead and switch gears a little bit and talk about the things that I find are, let's say, a little bit annoying or substandard for this unit. So first, right off the bat, the biggest downside of this unit is that it is open here in the middle. And so when you're doing dust collection, there is no dust collection for the bottom where the chips are coming out. They just kind of stack up here on the top of the base here. They get stuck in all these little nooks and crannies that happen to be inside these wings here. I don't know why there's so many cross supports in here, but vacuuming out all the chips and the waste material from here is really, really painful. It takes forever. I end up just blowing it out with air and then just sweeping it up off the floor in the end. So if I were to do this again, maybe what I would say is I'll probably close this in on the front and the back and then create a Y on the back side so the dust connector can connect to not only the port here that's on the front, but also to pull some of the chips out of the bottom here and hopefully create that vacuum that blows those chips out. So on that topic, this unit does kind of sort of have a fan, so it blows the chips up. Depending on the way that you're cutting and what the grain direction of the wood is, sometimes the chips do just fly kind of into your face, whether you have dust collection on or not, or they shoot straight out the bottom and just collect in this area down here, like I mentioned. And so that's not terribly awesome. It's not really great, but it's just something you need to learn to live with and deal with. So I've turned the unit around a little bit here. Let's talk a little about this dust collection port. This port does a fairly decent job of pulling the chips away from the top whenever they're coming in. But the diameter of this port, I have no idea what diameter it is supposed to be. It is not standard to anything. I can't connect my 4-inch hose to it. There's not a 2.5-inch hose for it either. So I did custom 3D print some adapters for this that attaches this to my 4-inch dust collection unit. So if you're interested, those are actually available for free on my website if you want to download those. You can get the Fusion file as well, so you can adjust through some of the parameters in the Fusion 360 file, the diameters of the holes if you want to make your own and 3D print them. All right, so let's talk about how you actually adjust the height of the router bit on this table. And I will tell you, this is the number one pain in the butt of this particular setup in this unit, is how you adjust the height of the router. So for this particular router, I do have a plunge base for it, but in this unit, it actually sits into the router table, and then you adjust it through a little keyhole on the top here. The only thing that you can adjust through the top is the fine router adjustment. And so to move the unit about a half an inch or so up or down is the most that you can do it. To move it large volumes, you have to come under here, you have to unclip it, you have to press a very specific little button on it, and there are two major adjustments that move it about an inch or two each. And that allows you to adjust major movements, and then you clip it back into place and then use the fine adjustment to do that fine sort of tuning of where you want your bit. It is not hard to do. It is just a pain in the butt. And so most of the higher end router tables have adjustments from the top where you can rapidly spin the entire unit up or down because the router is in the actual cage. The entire router moves up or down. In this case, what you're doing is you're actually just adjusting the spindle using the fine motor adjustments that are available on that plunge base as well as this particular unit. So, like I said, it's not horrible, but there are way better options out there. If I were to replace this entire base unit here, you can still use the table, but you can get a power lift, for example, here in the middle or something from like Rockler, where you can just adjust it with the magic wand, as I call it, right? And just replace this entire thing and attach your router to it. That would be much more optimal than the way that this is set up kind of out of the box. But those are very expensive. And the reason I got this particular table is because it's really not that expensive, and it got to me to where I needed to be. I needed a router table, and so for that purpose, it's very inexpensive and it works really well for the price point. So my last major gripe about this unit is the tabletop itself. I mentioned earlier that it is some form of metal. I think it is cast aluminum, although I am not entirely sure. It does not feel like cast iron at all, but it's much rougher than aluminum maybe would be. You can sort of hear that finish whenever I'm scraping my handle on it, or I'm rubbing my hand along it. And what I have found, here's what I don't like about it. I don't mind the texture or finish. That's no big deal, really. But when I am routing things face down, for example, I have just finished a cutting board and I'm putting a profile edge on it. It leaves black and gray streaks on the wood. So this is why I think it is aluminum. Aluminum has a tendency to do that, and I will show you some pictures of what it looks like whenever you actually rub some nice clean wood across it, and then you get these streaks on it. You have to go back and you have to re-sand everything. So I've modified my workflow a little bit so that I end up doing my routing before I do my final sanding, and it removes those marks. But it will be a lot nicer. Maybe I can seal this with some polyurethane or some lacquer or something to give it the you know, cover up whatever this metal is and, you know, give a nicer finish on it so that whenever you do use and you route it, it doesn't create those streaks on the wood. But I have to imagine that that would wear off fairly quickly. Hard to tell though, but like I said, maybe even sanding it down might help a little bit. But that's just the biggest downside of this table I have discovered so far. Well, that was the video. I hope you enjoyed it. So it was just a quick follow-up on this router table. Like I said, it is a great little table. It has some little nuances that I don't particularly care for, but given its price point, it is a great entry router table, and you do have some upgrade options by replacing this with a power lift in the future if you want to do that. And so making a little base and a stand for it is definitely helpful as long as it's nice and sturdy like this one is. But overall, I think I really like this table a lot. Eventually, I would like to take the router and actually put it in the wing of my table saw so that I have one less thing roaming around here in the garage. But overall, it has worked out very well, and I do recommend it, especially for the price point, which is very inexpensive. All right, thank you so much for watching the video. Thank you for getting this far. If you like this video, please consider giving it a thumbs up. If you don't like the video, I would appreciate a thumbs up anyway, but tell us why in the comments down below so we can make future videos better. If you're not already following me on Instagram, please consider doing so. That's where I post pictures of projects like this that become future videos. Once again, thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for getting this far. And don't forget to be inspired. I've created this lovely little stand for it. And so the stand is on wheels. It works very well. It's a little bright light.